All right, guys, you asked for it. We're going to be exposing the music industry one day at a time. And today I have none other than the greatest MG of the future, the man who exposes music producers, exposes artists, exposes the industry, gives you secrets on music theory, gives you secrets on music production technique, and always shows you the hacks in music production. And I wanted to bring him on because, what was it, last night you were doing a live stream?
Yeah, last night.
Last night he just went all the way in his live stream, and it was crazy good. And I just wanted to have the actual source give it to you guys. So today, I gave us a topic, and that topic is the dark capital of the music industry. I really want to expose where the money comes from, because a lot of people are chasing money and they feel let down because they don't get to the money. And I want to encourage people to stop chasing the illusions of the music industry. So thank you. Firstly, thank you for hopping in with me.
For having me, man. Thank you. And thank you for the intro. What kind of, I need an AI that, man. I need something AI. Like that.
Clip that. Yeah, please. Yeah. I mean, he showed me so many tips and tricks. Firstly, I have topics, guys, so we will stay organized. Okay. But firstly, shell companies. Have you heard of how they're being used in the music industry specifically or in general?
Not specifically to that, but I know that you create a shell corporation to hold money for you. And then it's just like there for you if you need to push things around. But it's basically a company that doesn't actually do nothing but allow you to put your money in a port and take it out of a port. That's it.
That's
without the eyes of the people in your primary businesses knowing what you're doing. So it's more like a, you know, one hand doesn't see what the other hand is doing type of thing.
Exactly. And in real estate, they use this a lot too. Sorry.
No, I got a better answer for you than that. You said, how's that used in the music industry?
Yeah.
Industry plants.
Big facts.
They're shells. We have all this money. We have all this Zeus. We have all this promo. We have all this marketing. They can't sing. They can't rap. But hey, if we can convince enough of the outlets to cover it, maybe we could break even or excel in other dynamics. And yeah, man.
Yeah.
Remember those hidden companies that there's a management company that was representing Tekashi 6ix9ine. That was when I first kind of thought about it. Because they don't tell you who his management individuals are. And it makes it seem like, oh, this guy from this label, this industry, but they never name him. And then you find out he was friends with Lucian Grainge's son, who signs all the checks. So you're like, oh, so maybe Lucian Grainge's son and this guy have their own, you know, little faction, if you will, to push out whoever they want to push out. But you don't know it's them.
Wow. Yeah, that's the key part to shell corporations. I'll use a real estate example real quick to what do they call it? Piggyback off what you said in Clubhouse. Is in real estate, you build shell corporations to protect certain assets. So if I have a home I'm about to buy, you don't just buy it and put it under Busy Works Beats. You buy it and put it under Busy Smirks Beats, because that separates the liability from that property. If someone to slip and fall on that property, they can't sue Busy Works Beats. They sue Busy Smirks Beats. And then all of your other assets are protected. So in this case, with the music industry, they can do the same exact thing. And hence, you know, what's it called? Words Connect?
Words Connect.
Words Connect, life insurance policies, death clauses. They separate all this stuff so that they're not liable for a lot of the fallback legally. Another term, overseas transactions. I didn't realize I was starting with a lot of maritime language. Overseas transactions, Cayman Islands, Swiss banks. What have you heard as far as general industry and then maybe specifically the music industry when it comes to overseas transactions, similar to a shell company?
It's similar, but when you have different bank accounts, we can just think about it in terms of crypto, really. So your overseas account in America, when we're using the fiat Federal Reserve note, when you get into Bitcoin, for instance, and then it doubles and it triples, well, it doubles and triples in USD. And if it doubles and triples in USD, then you owe somebody something. So your foreign account is like, I'm going to keep it in Bitcoin, but to keep my profit before Bitcoin dips, I might buy Doge and Ethereum, things that are still kind of stable. So you move it from one ocean to another. And the further you get out into that part of the web and crypto and stuff, you could be a millionaire over there. But the minute you exchange it back to these ports, you know, you got to pay this, do that, and a third. So I'm assuming that's just a digital representation of what those Cayman Island accounts and Swiss bank accounts really are. It's a different legislation. It's a different jurisdiction with different rules. So when you get three times the profit in Bitcoin, the Bitcoin mafia doesn't go, hey, knock on your door, you owe us 10%. Like, you know what I'm saying? So that's the digital representation of basically what you would do to quote unquote wash profits overseas or in the waters.
Wow, I love that analogy. I didn't even think to add crypto in that analogy. I just did a video with Micro Franzese. He's from the he was a former mafia boss, and he exposed the music industry. And I took clips from that and kind of explained a lot. But you made a good point, which is in the Bitcoin, what people don't understand is because they're not business owners traditionally in music. They're just creatives who do DBAs and different things. They don't understand how powerful the IRS is. The IRS is basically a legal mafia. In short, they will pull up with guns.
They're not a legal mafia. They work for Rome, the captain of the mafia. So if the captain of the mafia, remember in all those mafia movies, they always go to the church to do their confessional. They cleanse their sins with the bishop or the cardinal of that local municipality. That's also who you go to if your police department is acting up too. Wow. So if you have a problem with police, instead of going to the police, go to the church where the fraternity is registered. He's the real boss. That's the shadow boss, right? Not really a shadow boss, but we don't have the context to look at it that way because they told us, oh, separation of church and state. Woo-woo-woo. Yeah, on paper documents, but in practice, in alliances and allegiances, like we don't know the real story of what America Corporation is. So these concepts we only get from media, TV, some books, and then the controlled education system, who's all protecting and hiding the people who let them do that. It's not like we didn't get here organically and like, hey, we want to teach the kids how to write. Hey, I have a passion for history, math, science, industry, together. You need rather meritocracy. Like, no, that's not what happened at all. Sorry, guys. So a lot of these NGOs and these information-based agencies, think about it, FBI, grandson of Napoleon Bonaparte founded it.
Wow.
So that means Napoleon, his grandson, was alive at the same time. And then his grandson says, based on what I know about my daddy and my granddaddy, you know, I'm going to do the FBI for this corporation. So which side is the FBI on if it's Napoleon's?
Instant 3 a.m. We got a bonus 3 a.m.
Companies and stuff. You know, we wash our money in the Pirate Bay. Come on now.
Nah, that's so deep because now I'm starting to think, going back to crypto, is how a lot of people, even though it's a ledger, were you in the Web3 at all? I don't want to go down the crypto lane too much.
I know enough to be dangerous. I can throw some words around. I got context.
Okay, I'm going to keep it. It's like kind of surface, but kind of not surface. Is, okay, they go in, they take their US, they spend $100 on Bitcoin. Okay, now they take the Bitcoin earnings. Let's say it went up 10 to 20%. Then they'll stash it in this thing called Cardano, which is like a privacy coin. And then when it's in Cardano, you can't trace it. I don't know the technology behind it, but basically you can't trace the crypto transactions from that point. They're all anonymous. But you mentioned the other day, nothing's truly anonymous. Everything
taps into on the server. Mm-hmm. Yeah, as long as this stuff is, remember, crypto or Bitcoin and all this stuff is just code on the server. So the code and the network, if you log in, of course you're not going to see nobody, but the server that's holding the code has to know which IP address is accessing what. So they trace it kind of like a web, like all the heat and packet tracing from these servers to this guy's laptop, and you make the mistake and walk in someone's house and automatically jump on their open Wi-Fi and boom, now they know what device you have and what IPs you give off. So it's a reverse engineering thing, especially if you're talking about CIA, FBI, those guys. Me and you may not be able to do it. A company that you're trying to, you know, get capital from might not be able to see it. But if someone wants to see it, what do you think the NSA is doing? You think they're just sitting there doing this? You know what I'm saying? Like, sitting here like, oh man, this new thing that's been around for 20 years, what are we going to do?
Now you just...
Oh my God, how would we ever do our job?
You triggered a thought because I know some artists who got their career started based off of the Bitcoin and like the crypto. Like, for example, you heard what happened with Palace and Gumboy, their kind of feud or whatever.
Yeah.
But to me, from the outside in, Palace came up on, he said, a $20 million play in crypto. So, you know, he invested this much, got 20 out of it. That can make anybody jealous. That's just my perspective on it. And all that money is fueling all these creative things. Because at the end of the day, if you beat GTA 5, there's nothing else to do. What do you want to do? Most of the time, you want to be creative, make a movie, act out different scenes. That's why the GTA roleplay discords are so popular with T Grizzly. At the end of the day, once you pass the money thing and that whole validation thing, then you want to be creative. And that's where most people pull their money back to at the end of the day. That's why we're trying to help people not get finessed, because your true passion may be creativity. but you're being finessed by all these people. Long story short, what they would do is buy crypto, put it through Cardano, do a bunch of whatever transactions, come back with 100x more, and then exit through crypto, making it look like they had just crypto gains. But in reality, it was from all these dark pools and dark liquidity pools. Okay, and so
isn't it interesting that we call that stuff dark when that's how banks make money?
Oh, shoot. Why
do we call this stuff dark? Like, because dark gives the annotation that it's evil, sinister, or you're doing something bad. The only time making money and profit is bad so far, like this is just my limited understanding, is when you make profits without notifying people watching your pockets. So let's take the system out of it and just look at what it is. Like, I did all of this. I earned all of this. I figured this all out. And you are just a entity, government, websites, even dry snitching on you, all that, right? Why? Why do you care? What does it mean to you? You didn't have nothing to do with this. And that's the problem with crypto, right? Like, your governments have their own treasuries with their own notes. The reason why you owe them anything is because it's theirs. It's not the gold from the dirt. It's not the oil in your backyard. You exchange that energy into this thing. So you're agreeing to play Monopoly on their board, right? But what if I want to play Monopoly with different tenders, with different money, and I'm not even in your board because it's on the internet? The internet's not that state or governance's network or computers even. It's decentralized. So how can a central authority be clocking you if it's not their thing? And that's why they're always trying to, yo, we need our own CBDC. We need this. We need to put this on the Coinbase. And they got to shut down. Oh, my goodness. Like, because they're trying to keep track of what they are claiming to be theirs. And that's what the pirates and the dark web people are kind of always been signaling. Like, even like John McAfee and them. They're like, forget that part of the government. This ain't got nothing to do with you. I'm moving to Belize. I'm moving over here. You notice, like, even with the shell companies or the Cayman Islands accounts, a lot of your super rich people get renationalized in other countries. And remember, people and corporations in our demonstration are the same thing. So a corporation can get a nationality. So where's Apple's nationality? It's in Ireland. Oh, it's an American company with Chinese parts. No, it's not. It's Irish and it's Chinese. And it sells in America and creates stores in America. But why did it change its nationality? Why did it make it legal for that? Oh, because this state or this governance can offer me protections and insurance and security, and they're not taking all of this from me. They're not taking all this profit from me. So it's better to situate here. And you're seeing a lot of people called expats from the military and stuff. They do the same thing. They get a citizenship somewhere else, register there, find out how to move their money from bank to bank to bank, and sit up there like kings and pirates. And then remember when Donald Trump got in trouble and they're like, hey, you didn't pay this. You didn't do that. And he said, that's stupid. Why wouldn't I? Why would I do that? Why would I not organize myself so I don't owe you nothing? Remember, these are the super rich saying that. That's not like, you know, the grassroots. We got to feed the children. This is people who could have changed our world with fiat say, I'm not playing that game. So what does that say about everyone else who's trying to make money and be like them inevitably? Like, which ocean do you think you're inevitably going towards to with all this information? You're learning how to be free for real, and that's dangerous, and that's where the problems are, and that's the narrative that we weren't taught. We were taught to be dependent on the infrastructure. But if you go back 100, 200 years, you had your own farm, your own land, your own hustles. And then the king comes, and the king's like, hey, I want your tea tax. Remember, America is formed, right? Remember, that's the story they gave us. America is formed because someone took tea, poured it into the harbor because they were saying they were protesting unfair tax hike. You get a whole country out of that, right? Off the same principle. Now, this country, if you look at whatever inflation was in 1775 and what has happened since the Titanic, Federal Reserve, Trinity the Enemy Act, the Gold Act, and all this stuff through the 30s and 60s and then the 80s, Nixon and Reagan, Reaganomics, and every time they keep losing gold, they have no physical value. So even the money that we're given isn't constitutional money. It's not legal tender. A legal tender in our Constitution, if that's what we're following, silver, gold, and copper. A piece of paper that says debt note on it, it does not qualify for these things. That's why you can't pay debt. You can't pay debt with debt instruments. You have to pay debt with real legal tender. And that's a banking game. That's not our game. And that's the thing. There must be two sides. And we've only been taught and exposed to one. And then you get to the other side, or the dark side. And that's why I brought that to question. What's dark about it if that's how all the super rich we aspire to be conduct themselves.
Yeah, I love that because, again, in the other video I'm going to post later is how money moves and how it's laundered, basically, in the music industry. So, for example, you gave me a quick word connect thing, which is PayPal, for example. If I wanted to move all this money from USD over to GBP, Greatest British Pound or whatever, PayPal has a transaction fee. So they're the middleman, the cleaner of this transaction from this currency to the other. And to do that, you need money on hand to even exchange. And that's the liquidity pool we were talking about earlier. So in order to move from, you know, USD to crypto, maybe you don't keep 100% of your crypto. You're down 20% because you had it. They had to get a middleman to translate that money and launder it, I'll say, over to that currency so that people can escape. So the same thing with music. I'll make it simple. You have street money off of drugs, basically, for the most part, and illicit crimes. That money, you can't use it for a lot of things. You can't buy a house with that. You can't do a lot of things with cash because of what you just described, the government wanting its piece of everything. So they take that money and they do different nefarious things in the music industry with different artists and different things to clean up the money so that they have something on paper that they can claim. Like a lot of the streets tied into publishing. A lot of the streets funding the artists that go out there. Like, why do you think all these people are, not talking to you, but why does the audience think all these artists keep repping their hood and talking about this gang and all this? Because those were the investors, the street investors.
This is why checking in was so big and important in the conversations. When people were like, hey, did this person check in? I mean, those are the people who wait at the gate of a city. Those are the banditos, the bandits. You know, like with Robin Hood and stuff, like they didn't go in the city to do that. They waited for you to leave. They're in the forest. So it's kind of like that. And if you're a artist who's affiliated with a gang, especially, remember gangs have LLCs and incorporations too. Like Crips have merchandise, like real life. You know what I'm saying? It may not be in the gangbanger's name, or it might be in his sister's name or his mother's name, since she doesn't have the crime and the records and stuff. But it's still theirs, right? They're still the board members. So yeah, a lot of the street stuff, a lot of the gang or organized crime stuff is the only way you could afford to have the music industry we had through the 90s and 2000s. Because who else, what other jobs did we have, especially culturally, when you see the progression of the lower class, they weren't earning enough to buy radio slots, even if you saved all your money. It's impossible to think that anybody working from home with the keyboards in their studio and their bedroom is going to be able to do that. It's just, right. That's not what time it was 30 years ago, let alone now with the super duper inflation we're living through. So if you think about it like that, to get that extra bump to actually do something, you'll notice that with any one hit wonder, man, they come out and they're like, where did this artist come from? How did they get noticed? And then you watch their interviews and see their brother in the background. And you look at their brother, and you look him in the eyes, you're like, oh, all right, he might be one of those guys, right? Like the artist may not be that. Like Lil Uzi Vert doesn't seem to be that, but you look at some of his entourage, you'd be like, oh. And like you said, they can clean it through the tours. Oh, we did 50 shows, and they paid us in cash. They don't have to. I'm not going to say they don't have to report that, but you think they're reporting those club appearances where they get hands full of cash, with the club owner also able to afford, I don't know, a $50,000 visit at a club that makes $5,000 a night on alcohol. Where do you think he got that money from?
I was just about to say that. I'm like, oh man, because these artists are doing the shoulder to wrist money flexes stacked up hundreds. I'm like, what club on a Tuesday night is making this much cash off of 200 people that showed up? Do the math. 2 million divided by 200 is 10,000 a person. I think
that's not happening that way, sir. And it may not even be happening from the club, too, because remember, if they're gangs, they're networks, like the Underground Railroad was a network for, whatever that was. So the same thing with these clubs and these tour locations, especially the cities, if you're paying attention or if you're interested in noticing.
Yeah,
that could be a cover for something totally different.
Yeah, and the reason I want to pause here is because I just want producers and artists to just understand the illusion so you know what game you're playing. If you're trying to compare yourself against so-and-so, you guys, okay, I'm going to break it down really quickly, is that, criminal organizations like the Mafia, for example, were known to buy laundromats, cash businesses, laundromats, ice cream shops, clubs, okay, because they get a lot of hand-to-hand cash. And you could disguise the street money as income through that specific business and then legitimize it by paying taxes. So ultimately, the government may know about this stuff, but as long as they get their translation fee the same way as PayPal does, they don't really investigate that deeply, even though it is against federal laws.
They all end up getting in trouble, like people who are super rich off the streets. You made a good point. You notice how like the government has to know, right? Because the emergency room knows when there's overdoses, and everyone else knows when there's evictions, and everyone else knows like, oh, something's magically happening in this community. Where are they getting it from? So to think they don't know is kind of crazy, especially today with everyone with one of these in their pocket. But for whatever reason, they don't utilize the technology for that, for all the petty crimes. That you notice there has to be like a financial threshold for them to go after you, right? And then when they arraign you, what is the first thing you have to pay as soon as you get knocked for any crime? It don't matter what it is. What do they call it when you finally get apprehended and you want to get out? What do you have to pay?
What's it called? Bail?
Bond.
Bond. Oh, I always mix those two up. Bond. Okay.
It's a literal bond. It generates interest.
Oh, wow.
That's requirements for the judges. They're not using that language. It's all banking. It's all banking. So every person that goes to court or trial has to pay into the bond. And that's on the market, the same way the private prisons are. Like, it's profitable to do crime. So whether I catch you in all your glory, you're skating, you're going away, and then you make enough, and then we hit you, and we take the cash, whoop, 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 or we finally pinch you, Gotti, and then we take everything we could take that you put in your name, which is not much, as you described. And then you're sitting on a bond in this energy cell factory. You're making money for us either way, dead, you know, out there or in here. So wow. It's just a matter of selection for real and agendas. Because we're assuming that everyone in your government are good guys or meritocracies, or that they didn't get money somehow to lobby, or they didn't get money somehow to run and promote and print all those ads and all that stuff that costs thousands of dollars. But you told me my local senator or mayor or somebody, he was just a hardworking computer programmer at $60,000 a year. But he got some redneck down in the woods by the bayou to give him $1 million to run for nothing. Okay, thank you. Please come again. Like, no, we got to grow up, man. We saw the Ozarks. Stop playing with me.
Yeah, the Ozarks. That's what I was thinking of.
Stop playing with me, man.
That politician who took all that those bribes and stuff. Yeah, I want to go back wait, there was a word you said, and it's escaping me. Money laundering in the music industry. I'll just go to the next term. It'll pop up later. Forgive me. But ticket scalping is another way. There's dark capital within these. And again, I want to explain to the audience, the reason we're exposing this is so that you're not playing that game and not comparing yourself to that game. We're showing you legit stuff on this channel. MG talks about how to grow your audience, how to actually do the craft so you actually become skilled to then be good at this and then translate that into actual fandom and then growing your audience that type of way. I might talk about more businessy stuff sometimes, but the goal is to not use Black Cat, to not use illicit, to not use all these dark sources that these other folks are using. Because again, it's like comparing our YouTube videos to somebody who's using SM Zeus to get the first 30,000 in the first 3 days to make us look like our videos aren't doing anything. When meantime, it's botting, you know, it's bots.
Correct.
So I lost my thought, so it'll come back to me. But I guess ultimately I was just getting into, there's a tax to be paid, you know, render unto Caesar's what is Caesar's, you know, and that's how the music industry works. You know, in the streets, they call it draft. It's like a tax. They may not extort you, but they expect you to pay them in equity when you come do the live shows. Here's what I was going to say. Thank you, brain. Okay. I'll keep it short and then we'll move to the next term here because I have about 20 terms and we got about 20 minutes. All right. So let me say this quickly is that, where does the music for beats come from? I think you brought that question up too. It's like, where does the money come from to even buy the music, to move the music? And the ultimate end game for most artists is that live touring. That's where they get most of the cash that they can keep because it's not under the terms of the record label as much, unless they're 360 dealed out or whatever it is. So for example, if I'm selling a beat for 200, it's because the artist thinks they can flip that 200 into 2000 with streaming. Major producers who work with major artists, they sell their beats for $5,000, $10,000 because the artist who they work with knows that one show can bring them $30,000. And that's one third of one show. That's nothing. and they'll go on a tour for, you know, 100 shows throughout the year, maybe, to then recoup off of that one thing plus publishing and all that type of stuff. So right. at the end of what I'm trying to say is, because they know that there's an end goal to that money being spent, they look at your beat like an investment. But if people are looking at your beat like there's no end game to get more money, then they're looking at it like a hobby or a loss leader. So that's all I had to say about that. But I want to move to ticket scalping is another form of money laundering that these labels do. In short, that means buying tickets in bulk and then reselling them. And they do this, one, with street funds, street promoters, all that type of stuff. They could buy tickets from whoever for however many thousands, okay? And then they resell them. Like, okay, let me ask you this question, because I don't want to like me be so by the book. Have you been to Vegas before?
Not yet, no.
Okay, have you seen...
I'm familiar with it, though.
Like the street promoters who are, like, just even on Instagram, like street promoters who are like, who is this dude? And he's like throwing a $500,000 show.
Yep. It's like, I know, familiar. They try to get you going there and stay at the hotels. They give you free stuff. They try to lure you in. Yeah.
Yeah. They even buy people to come. They give out free tickets on the street in Vegas. You'll be walking. This is an anecdote real quick. You'll be walking down the strip and then some promoter will come up to you. They're looking for, you know, the girls and they're looking for couples. And they say, hey, we'll give you these free tickets to come to our show tonight, because they need people to fill that venue to make it look like the cash that's flowing through there is real. Isn't that crazy? So I don't know if you have any promoter stories or what, but that's something that shocked me when I went to Vegas. Like, how bold of these guys.
but think about what you just described. You described payola. That is the whole idea. Like when Michael Jackson bought a million copies of his own record so that he can get into the charts. And then once he's in the charts, the real eyes show up and then the demand goes up for touring. So was it $1 million investment or a million times however much each record costs? So was it a 20 million, 50 million investment or was it dark, illegal? You know what I mean? Like, it gets real shaky, man, when you think Michael Jackson bought a million of his own records, right? I'm not talking about someone from the last 5 to 10 years. I'm talking about like one of the pop greats.
Wow.
And maybe he did it legally. What stops him from doing that? What if he reported it, right? Like, what if he claimed it as a loss or whatever, however he did in his infrastructure? But still, those a million seats are empty.
Sorry, Papa popped up, my bad. 10 minutes? I thought we had 20 minutes. Okay, I guess we have 10 minutes left. Forgive me. Okay, we got to have a part. What is this? Part 4. I'm on part 3 already with MG. But if you would love to come back for another part, I'd be glad to have you again. Real quick, you just reminded me too. There's a French philosopher who described the definition of desire. And he said, desire is when one person sees another person desiring something. So for example, if I see MG looking or talking about Scalar 2, for example, because he has core packs for Scalar 2. What do you do? What are those called?
Yeah, those are core books.
Core books, forgive me. Core books for Scalar 2, for example. He's talking about in his video, I see him desiring Scalar 2. It goes, it makes me want to buy Scalar 2. And then it makes me want to buy his specific core book because he put so much attention and focus on it. And that's what content creation is all about.
Correct.
So, sure. So with what those examples we just gave is, you know, if someone's buying a million of their own record to get recognized as like a top selling record, all the other people go, wow, a million people bought this thing. I need to buy it too because they desire it that much. And it's our human ability to save time when it comes to judgment because somebody else already spent the time to see if it's good or not. The same way you go on Amazon and you look for the ratings and how many ratings there are. It's the same exact thing. What about, so another way people in the music industry, we're going to have a part 4. This is crazy. I'll let you speak on this because I know you talk about this a lot. So I'll skip one and go to falsified digital streams, paying for bots. Can you just kind of freestyle on how bots are used in the music industry?
There's a couple of ways. I mean, one is to build your fan base, of course. So instead of you paying Instagram to promote your page to attract new followers, you can pay for a bot or a script or just a chunk of code, and you can bypass some of those regulations or automate some of those platform regulations to generate followers and attractions quick. Even the automated DMs and stuff, like stuff you have to pay a social media manager for, or something you would get a phone call from Meta, if you're super famous, to organize for you. The bots take you out of that pay system. Remember, that's not governmental. That's platform. You know, you're bypassing the law of the platform, the user agreement. So a lot of people do that. The fake plays and stuff. Well, since you know each play equals 0.00003 cents, if you can figure out how to automate a farm of phones, or man, with those new NVIDIA servers, forget about it, bro. That's going to be rampant. But anyway, like, if you have something, access to that at another job, for instance, right? You're a network engineer, or your uncle is, or your daddy is. Hey, can you install this code on here and make it play this song for 15 to 30 seconds every day? Well, it doesn't matter if anyone listens to it, right? At that level, like, if you take away the passion of being an artist and go into business mode, well, I have the hardware to generate, I don't know, $30,000 a month from YouTube and Spotify. Does it matter if I'm a good something? Does it matter if the song hits? Does it even matter that you know that I did that? So imagine all the people who do it for clout and we find out and expose, per se, versus all the people, remember they tell you how many fake bands are on Spotify or something?
Wow.
Like, that's kind of like a dog whistle. There's a bunch of fake bands on there. There's a bunch of fake songs on there. Artists put blank music up there and tell their fans to play it while they go to sleep type of stuff. So if you're just able to generate random or at scale anonymous bands, and each one only does, well, I don't know, $30 a month because you're right beneath the radar. What if you own 100 of them? Because your uncle got the server.
I just saw Chad Focus did two interviews with Brandman Sean. Shout out to Brandman Sean and Corey, and DJ Payne One and his co-host. And he basically says, and what I like about his interviews is not the practice of what is promoted, but more so the exposing of this happening, so that people stop chasing an illusion. That's what I like most about the message. But he talks about how in his attempts to stream his own record, the threshold's about 3,000 streams, I think, per day, if I'm not mistaken. And yep. It goes back to our conversation about shell corporations. He would talk about how he would build game apps to then put his music in the game and create fake streams that way, so it looks legit, or using different cellular phones or networks. I don't know all the science behind it. But again, they're creating these shell companies so that they're spreading out the risk and liability, so it doesn't look like user X, Y, and Z is just streaming his own stuff 3,000 times a day.
And you see why they're forcing the blockchain. That's why they're forcing us into that. They're not scared or nervous in that. That's going to be like the transparent. So when you get a music MP3 file that's a digital asset with an NFT or a signature to it, you know how many nodes on a network is accessing it streamingly exactly. And then you know how many of those accounts or nodes in the network that are doing that, how many different NFTs that they preload into their cache of their device that's going to stream it. That's why they need this new network. So the next iTunes or the next YouTube, your history of what you watch or what you liked is going to be tied to like your, the thing that they worry about with China coming here, the social credit score, is going to affect all of that, bro. Every little thing you do on a device is going to have your signature, man. And that's the sell of transparency. I know how much my ad dollars are getting. I know how many people actually played it and not a random bot. Although AI could probably still do that. But we're going to act like, you know, for me and you, it's like, I only streamed 10 credits of the new Young Thug album. You know, you shouldn't charge me. You know what I mean? Like, it's different. It's not what we think it is.
Darn, it's like you read my mind. I literally put on this piece of paper $9.99 per month. Because in the other video with Michael Franzese, when I was breaking that down, I said, think about Spotify. I'll keep this short because we have 3 minutes left. I said, all these people are putting their music on Spotify. One, they have to pay to do it. That's already the biggest jug of the history of everything. Secondly, they're driving all their audience to Spotify. You're giving Spotify real users who they can go to their shareholders and say, hey, our company's growing X, Y, and Z rate per month. Give us more capital. That's real cash off of users that you drove to Spotify for free just to promote your song. So you're already down two elements. One, you paid to distribute it because you're the fool. Two, not fool. I won't call people fools.
No hate, nothing.
And two, you're giving these companies the real equity, which is the attention. And then three, they're driving people to their competition. And four, think about it this way. You get paid 0.000 whatever cents a stream. What happens to the other $9.99 that I'm paying every single month? Nobody ever questions that. And that's the part that, you know, is the dark side of the music industry. I'll keep it that way. But I'll let you continue. You sparked that thought.
No, that's a good thing. And then if you get to the dark side, how many of those plays and streams that are fake isn't coming from the platform itself? They're
Dang.
counting outside fake streams so that they don't rip off their pay to enter model. But to say they don't have, remember back in the day when we made websites, you get a counter, HTML code for a counter, and you could type in how many count you want to start at. Like, oh, this page had 1,000 visits. I was
Think
outside, man. Stop playing with me.
of the
Stop playing with me.
MySpace. That's hilarious. And to those simple forms of like trickery, you would just hit refresh 1,000 times and it would say, hey, your song was played 15 times. All you got to do is just hit refresh. But they figured out ways around that. But it's still, I'm just telling people, do you guys really think that these mentalities went away with the CD? Just because they can't, just because the mob can't like tax you and extort your CD distribution doesn't mean it's not happening with these companies. We have a minute left. I'm going to let you say your final thoughts. And I wanted to thank you because, again, this series,
Appreciate
I didn't expect the series to pick up. So we'll see how part two does. But I want to let you have the final words here.
Now, man, I don't. Well, my big message is always to not let new information or stuff like this trouble you. It's nothing troubling. It's just an awakening and an awareness of the type of environment you've lived through, especially in America. Like, that's what it's built on. Just read the first stories. It's all the same thing. Nothing's really changed. But to position yourself as a creative, keep some integrity for yourself. You don't just be, what do they say? When in Rome, do what Romans do. I'm not Roman, so I don't relate.
He says, so I don't really. I'm glad you capped it before the minute so I could actually properly end the video. I want to thank you, MG of the Future. Everybody go subscribe to his YouTube, check out his core books. He has new products coming. He has curated samples. He has all types of stuff. Go to MG, is it.com?
Yeah, mgthefuture.com.
MGthefuture.com. I bought a lot of stuff. I got to go check it out to see what I don't have. So I'm going to check you out soon enough. Wishing you well. Peace out, brother.
Appreciate you.